yo voy a hacer la presentación de las tres personas. La primera yo voy a hacer en castellano, en homenaje a los vecinos argentinos. María Gabriela Casnati va a presentar una comunicación sobre el concepto de eponimía en el argumento final de la inmortalidad del alma. La doctora María Gabriela Casnati estudió filosofía por la Universidad de Buenos Aires en Argentina, es profesora de la materia Historia de la Filosofía Antigua en la misma universidad, es autora de diversos artículos sobre temas de filosofía antigua en revistas especializadas como Tópicos y otros, y miembro de proyectos de investigación de la Universidad de Buenos Aires del CONICET. Su tema de interés es el estudio de la ontología platónica, principalmente en el Fedón y la República, en la sección crítica del Parménides en los desarrollos tardíos del Timeo. After that, we have Lenka Karfikova from the Czech Republic talking about the soul and life, the soul and ratio, Augustine's criticism of the final proof in Plato's Phaedo. She is a professor of philosophy at Charles University in Prague and a researcher of the Center for Patristic, Medieval and Renaissance Studies in Olomouc in the Czech Republic. She has many publications like the Esse ad Pulchrum Esse, Schönheit in der Theologie Hugos von St. Victor, Gregory of Nyssa, Contra Eunomium, an English version with supporting studies, and Grace and the Will According to Augustine, and von Augustin zu Abelard, the student zum Christlichen Dank. After that, we have Matthew Walker, assistant professor of humanities in Yale, and he has studied in Yale University, obtained a PhD in philosophy in 2008, and has a selection of articles, one titled How Narrow is Aristotle's Contemplative Ideal. Another one, another publications are book chapters like The Functions of Apollodorus and Confucian Worries about the Aristotelian Sophos. And now we immediately pass the word to Maria Gabriela Casnati.
Good morning. Thank you for being here. I will read my paper in Spanish, but slowly. El concepto de eponimía en el argumento final de la inmortalidad del alma. En el presente trabajo nos proponemos en un primer momento analizar la caracterización que aparece en el Fedón y también en la República de la forma como una unidad sobre múltiples particulares que por participación adquieren sus propiedades, y señalaremos que este es el fundamento que da lugar a las aporías de la primera parte del Parménides. A continuación, analizaremos pasajes del argumento final de la inmortalidad del alma en el Fedón, donde se presenta la noción de eponimía, y nos concentraremos en el aspecto derivativo que con ella se introduce. Afirmaremos que la predicación epónima es posible en virtud de la explicación que da cuenta de por qué un particular sensible puede justificadamente ser denominado a partir de una forma. Resaltaremos la fuerte impronta del lenguaje de la inmanencia que aparece en estos pasajes, donde se insiste en algún tipo de presencia de la forma en las cosas. Concluiremos que cuando Platón apela a la eponimía para caracterizar el vínculo semántico que existe entre una idea y los particulares que participan de ella, no alude simplemente a una comunidad de nombre entre ideas y particulares sensibles, sino que aparece implicada una derivación nominal unida a la dependencia ontológica de la cosa nombrada respecto de la idea de la cual participa, en tanto el particular posee o tiene en sí el carácter de la forma. Bien, es sabido que para Platón las ideas existen realmente y son el único tipo de entidad al que puede aplicarse sin limitación la calificación de ser. La idea es autocatauzó, una realidad existente en sí y por sí, que reviste independencia ontológica. Desde el punto de vista semántico, hay una multiplicidad de particulares sensibles a los que nombramos del mismo modo y postulamos una forma con el mismo nombre. Esto se advierte con claridad en República 10, 596a, 5-8, donde Sócrates pregunta, ¿quieres que comencemos examinando esto por medio del método acostumbrado? Pues creo que acostumbrábamos a postular una idea única para cada multiplicidad de cosas a las que damos el mismo nombre, tautón ónoma. Allí, el método habitual es el de suponer la existencia de una idea única para cada multiplicidad de cosas sensibles que tienen idéntico nombre. Esto es, cuando hay un término general o predicado que puede atribuirse del mismo modo a múltiples cosas que exhiben un rasgo común. Platón contrapone la unicidad de la idea a la multiplicidad de los particulares sensibles, y en ese sentido la idea constituye un uno sobre lo múltiple. Una concepción similar aparece en Fedón 78D10E2, donde Sócrates pregunta, cito, ¿qué hay de las múltiples cosas bellas, como por ejemplo hombres, caballos, vestidos, o cualquier otra cosa de este tipo, o bien de las cosas iguales, o de todas las que reciben el mismo nombre, tonekeinos, homónimos, que aquellas? Aquí vuelve a aparecer, fin de la cita, aquí vuelve a aparecer una multiplicidad de cosas sensibles que reciben el mismo nombre de las formas, se utiliza el término homónimos, y son, por tanto, homónimas a ellas. Lo primero que surge preguntar es por qué a cosas diferentes, diferentes hombres, caballos o vestidos, las llamamos con el mismo nombre. La razón del Fedón pareciera ser que comparten una misma propiedad. Leemos, por ejemplo, que todas las cosas bellas son bellas en virtud de lo bello, ¿no? Tocalá, tapanta, tacalá, en Fedón 100D78. También que es en virtud de lo bello como llegan a ser bellas las cosas bellas, tocalá. Tacalá, Gignen Taikalá, en 100E23. En general, diríamos que si de cada una de múltiples cosas sensibles grandes afirmamos que es grande, la razón no es otra que la magnitud, diatomeguetos. Si nos preguntamos ahora por qué estos múltiples que tienen el mismo nombre y comparten una característica entre sí son homónimos a su vez de las formas, la respuesta platónica del Fedón apela a la participación. Cito 100C4D6. A mí me parece que si hay alguna otra cosa bella al margen de lo bello mismo, no podría ser bella por ninguna otra cosa que por participar, me teje de eso que es bello. Y unas líneas después, ninguna otra cosa hace bello a algo, sino la presencia de, parusía, o bien la comunidad con, coinonía, aquello que es bello, como quiera que fuere que se tenga que denominar a tal relación. Fin de la cita. Es bien sabido que Platón no explica con precisión la relación participativa, pero el hecho es que aquí eso no parece interesarle, sino solamente afirmar que existe una relación apropiada entre ámbitos y que es en virtud de relacionarse apropiadamente con las formas que los particulares tienen sus características y además que ambas instancias poseen el mismo nombre. Si volvemos ahora al pasaje de Fedón 78, de 10 y 4, donde se pregunta por las, cito, múltiples cosas bellas, como por ejemplo hombres, caballos, vestidos, o bien las cosas iguales, o todas las que reciben el mismo nombre que aquellas, que se encuentran siempre del mismo modo, pero se comportan del modo totalmente contrario a aquellas, y no se encuentran, por así decir, jamás del mismo modo, en el mismo estado, ni respecto de sí mismas, ni unas respecto de otras, fin de la cita, vemos que el término homónimos se aplica a individuos sensibles que poseen A. el mismo nombre de la idea de la que participan y, además, B. una naturaleza inferior respecto del ser pleno de las ideas. Pero creemos, ambas son propiedades diferentes y no es lícito derivar la segunda a partir de la primera. Es muy probable que aquí Platón apele intencionalmente a cierta ambigüedad de la homonimia, que supone identidad de nombre pero implica diferente definición o naturaleza, algo que estaba siendo desarrollado por el propio Speusipo, que no deja claro si se trata de una distinción entre nombres o entre entes. En suma, los pasajes citados dan cuenta de múltiples particulares sensibles que, 1. Comparten un nombre con la forma, 2. Tienen una naturaleza imperfecta en comparación con la forma, y 3. A estos particulares puede asignarse la propiedad que exhiben en virtud de esa participación de la forma. Tengamos en cuenta que para Platón apelar a las formas, esto es, a la distinción de dos ámbitos entre los que se opera algún tipo de relación, no implica solamente una propuesta ontológica acerca de sensibles e inteligibles, sino también, y derivada de ella, una propuesta semántica sobre el lenguaje y la comunicación. En ese sentido, creo, en tanto no se explique la relación ontológica que vincula a particulares y formas, tampoco podrán darse mayores precisiones respecto de la relación semántica que los une y que a esta altura de la obra se menciona como homonimia, esto es, una relación simétrica según la cual se aplica el mismo nombre a entes distintos sin que ello implique derivación o dependencia ontológica. Creemos que esta indeterminación respecto de la relación participativa en el Fedón es intencionalmente retomada en la primera parte del Parménides para dar lugar a los dos argumentos regresivos y al así llamado dilema de la participación. En dicha sección crítica, Platón asimila una relación semántica simétrica entre entes diversos, que como vimos aparece en el Fedón, con la relación ontológica de participación que, si bien no es explicada ni desarrollada hasta el argumento final de la inmortalidad del alma, tampoco se presenta como una relación simétrica, sino más bien derivativa. Si dejamos de lado, por ejemplo, todos los pasajes del Fedón que insisten en la deficiencia ontológica de lo del sensible respecto de la forma, el largo pasaje, por ejemplo, 74c, 77a, y nos concentramos más bien en que entre formas y particulares se da una cierta relación de participación, en virtud de la cual lo sensible adquiere de la forma la propiedad que exhibe, y tenemos en cuenta además que a ambos tipos de entidades se aplica el mismo nombre simétricamente, entonces es fácil derivar que ambos ámbitos poseen del mismo modo sus propiedades y que es simétrica también la relación ontológica que los vincula. Y de allí las aporías del Parménides. Volvamos al Fedón. En el marco de la última prueba que se ofrece en favor de la inmortalidad del alma, en 102a, 107b, Platón introduce una serie de precisiones y distinciones de gran importancia. El nuevo argumento retoma la fórmula platónica según la cual, como ya señalamos, las cosas bellas particulares son bellas, tienen características, a causa de la forma de belleza, tócalo, pantatacalacalá. Pero ahora resulta insoslayable reconocer una metafísica que tiene en cuenta no solo particulares que se relacionan con formas, sino también una instancia que podríamos denominar, siguiendo a muchos autores, propiedades o caracteres inmanentes e incluso determinaciones de la forma, que sirve de intermediaria entre las formas de las que son copias y los particulares a los que pertenecen. Si bien el tema genera controversia y no hay consenso acerca de si estas propiedades en las cosas son miembros de la ontología del Fedón o no, consideramos innegable que Platón introduce en este cuarto argumento una explicación metafísica más detallada y que exacerba el lenguaje de la inmanencia. Sócrates agrega ahora que, como consecuencia de la participación, el particular sensible posee o tiene en sí el carácter, que es una particularización de la forma en que participa y cuya existencia no podría darse sin el particular en el que participa. Leamos algunos pasajes donde este aparece, voy a hacer una selección de 102b3, 103e5. ¿No es cierto que cuando dices que Simias es más alto que Sócrates y más bajo que Fedón, estás afirmando que Simias están presentes, einan en ton simia, ambas determinaciones, tanto la grandeza como la pequeñez? Seguramente no piensas que es en razón de su misma naturaleza, vale decir, por ser simia, como simia sobrepasa a otra persona, sino más bien por la grandeza que resulta tener. Alá, Tomegetzei, Jotinjanei, Ejo. Y a su vez tampoco crees que sobrepasa a Sócrates por el hecho de que Sócrates sea Sócrates, sino más bien porque Sócrates posee determinada pequeñez, Jotis microteta, Eje, Hijo Sócrates, respecto de la propia grandeza de simias. En efecto, a mí me parece no solo que la grandeza misma, autotoméritos, jamás admitiría ser al mismo tiempo grande y pequeña, sino también que la grandeza que está presente en nosotros, toingemín méritos, jamás recibe la pequeñez ni admite ser sobrepasada. Antes se decía que es a partir de una cosa contraria como se venera la cosa contraria a ella. Y ahora, en cambio, que el contrario mismo no podría llegar a ser nunca el contrario de sí mismo, ni el que está en nosotros, toingemín, ni aquel que existe en la naturaleza, toentefisei. La situación es tal que no solo la idea misma, autotoeido, merece su propio nombre para siempre, tu autú, onómatos eistonae chrono, sino que también hay algo diferente a lo ti, que sin ser dicha idea, posee siempre su forma, egetein, ekeinum morfen aei, mientras existe. Fin de la cita. Aparece aquí una distinción entre formas, autotomégetos, caracteres o propiedades en la cosa, toengemin mégetos, y particulares, egofaidoxinias. Las formas no pueden poseer propiedades opuestas, ni tampoco pueden los caracteres inmanentes, es decir, La grandeza en nosotros no puede admitir la pequeñez. Esta última se retirará o perecerá ante el avance de su opuesto. Por el contrario, yo, el particular, puedo, siendo grande, volverme pequeño sin dejar de ser quien soy. Esto es, mientras ambos miembros de una pareja de determinaciones contrarias pueden estar presentes, incluso simultáneamente, en la misma cosa, las ideas mismas nunca pueden recibir una idea contraria ni participar de ella. La pequeñez misma nunca puede ser grande, ni la grandeza misma podrá ser pequeña. Ni tampoco pueden recibir a sus contrarios ni participar de ellos las propiedades o caracteres que están presentes en las cosas. No parece casual que Platón insista tanto en esta sección del diálogo en utilizar el verbo ejo y sus compuestos. En estas líneas yo conté más o menos 13 apariciones, dando a entender la posesión de propiedades por parte de las cosas, algo que reaparece cuando introduce un segundo modelo explicativo a partir de formas que califica como más elaborado o sutil, ¿no? Con Sotero en 105c2, y según el cual algo es caliente por la presencia del fuego en él, un cuerpo está enfermo por la presencia de la fiebre y vivo por la presencia del alma, y un número es impar por la unidad. En las niñas que se ofrece esta explicación, encontramos 4 veces la forma en genetai, que significa literalmente algo que le llega adentro, algo que se le hace presente. La insistencia al utilizar en todos los casos estas formas verbales resalta claramente la idea de inmanencia de una propiedad en la cosa. Ahora bien, nos interesa señalar que, en el marco de esta reformulación más detallada de la relación entre ámbitos, la participación de la cosa, de la idea, tiene como contrapartida la presencia en la cosa de una cualidad, y esta es la base para la aplicación del nombre a la cosa sensible que posee esta cualidad. Y es en este marco que se introduce en el diálogo el término eponimía, noción asimétrica que supone una derivación nominal como resultado de la dependencia ontológica entre ámbitos, para dar cuenta del aspecto semántico que vincula a la cosa nombrada con la forma de la cual participa. Sintetiza Fedón en 102b1.3 que cada una de las ideas es algo existente y que es por participar de ella por lo que las restantes cosas reciben la denominación correspondiente, de eponimían ischei, a las mismas ideas. Y en el mismo sentido agrega Sócrates pocas líneas después, en 112.11.2, que, cito, es de este modo como Sibias recibe la denominación eponimían ischei, tanto de ser pequeño como de ser grande, por encontrarse en medio de los otros dos, sometiendo su pequeñez a la grandeza del uno que ha de sobrepasarlo y presentando su propia grandeza al otro. Fin de la cita. De este modo, al dar cuenta de la relación participativa como un estar en presencia de las propiedades inmanentes, imágenes de las formas en las cosas, Platón enfrenta a esta explicación el aspecto semántico e introduce la eponimía para caracterizar la vinculación existente entre una idea, por un lado, y los particulares que participan de ella y son denominados, según ella, por el otro. En tanto la predicación epónima debe estar siempre respaldada por algún tipo de explicación de por qué la cosa nombrada es nombrada a partir de algo, esta condición se ve satisfecha en el argumento que estamos analizando del Fedón por el hecho de que la cosa sensible recibe el mismo nombre que aquello a lo que se asemeja por poseer su mismo carácter, y esto constituye la base para la aplicación del nombre de la idea a las cosas sensibles que poseen la propiedad correspondiente. Es importante señalar la diferencia entre la eponimía que aquí se menciona y la homonimia de 78e, donde, como vimos, la relación de participación no estaba mayormente especificada y a nivel semántico solamente se afirmaba una comunidad de nombres entre ideas y cosas. Al denominar epónima a la relación semántica entre particulares y formas, Platón estaba aportando nuevos elementos. Está diciendo que entre ambos tipos de entidades hay una relación y que esa relación es apropiada y no arbitraria para que algo pueda ser nombrado derivativamente a partir de otra cosa. Platón apela aquí a la eponimía para caracterizar la vinculación que existe entre una idea y los particulares que participan de ello, pero ya no desde la ambigua comunidad de nombre entre ideas y cosas, sino que aparece implicada una derivación nominal unida a la dependencia ontológica de la cosa nombrada respecto de la idea de la cual participa, en tanto el particular posee o tiene en sí el carácter de la forma. Y esto es algo que recién aparece en el Fedón en el curso de una explicación que pone de manifiesto que hay ciertas propiedades o caracteres que no son las formas mismas, sino aloti, y que están presentes en las cosas. Si lo dicho hasta
al respecto. Y después, si este desarrollo del Fedón, donde se insiste y que quizás se retoma en el Parménides, como bien citás vos, que parece aludir al carácter que está presente en la cosa como resultado de la participación, ¿podría echar alguna luz o no sobre esa expresión tan problemática que aparece en el contexto del argumento de la reminiscencia, autata isa, que es la única aparición junto con la expresión del Parménides, autata homoia, que son tan enigmáticas, y si esa noción de carácter a vos te parece que puede ser la que esté en juego o no?
Empiezo por el final, que me lo acuerdo más. Es todo un antecedente esas líneas de donde hay tres términos diferentes para aludir a estos iguales, donde claramente podría verse ahí que hay dos términos, autata isa y geisotes, que no están refiriendo a la misma cosa, sino que algunos serían propiedades inmanentes. Podría ser. Yo lo leí con detalle y primero estuve muy entusiasmada con encontrar ahí estos caracteres inmanentes. Y después me pareció que leyéndolo, ahora no tengo los elementos, pero leyendo muy detalladamente, creo que me convenció más para pensar que no, que ahí no. Geisotes no está refiriendo a las propiedades inmanentes, sino es otra locución de la forma, lo cual también es complicado, porque hay una frase que parece redundante. Hay una redundancia que ahí está molestando, ¿no? Porque ¿por qué Platón estaría diciendo de esa manera la expresión? Pero creo ahora, por ahí dentro de 6 meses, cambio, porque estoy en un vaivén. Adherí profundamente a que ahí había propiedades inmanentes, de hecho ahí así lo puse en la tesis, pero en el último año cambié y creo que no. Pero bueno, a ver, si uno puede encontrarlo allí es porque estamos viendo un lenguaje fuertemente inmanente, ¿no? Que por ahí no aparece en las primeras partes del diálogo, cuando dice, bueno, esa relación, no sé, pero además como una cierta, no es lo que me interesa, llámalo como... Bueno, que ahí también hay un problema, ¿no? Con el prosgegómeno, ¿de qué está hablando? ¿Como sea que haya que llamarlo? ¿O como sea que se dé esa relación? Ahí hay un problema textual fuerte. O sea, podría ser metafísico o podría ser semántico. Y no está muy claro. De hecho, Strahan le hace el cambio a la versión de Burnett en ese término. Es notable. Pero bueno, creo que el Fedón va creciendo en esta falta de explicación a intentar dar explicaciones en el último argumento. Y lo que se acrecienta es el lenguaje de la inmanencia. Es impresionante el uso de ejon, parejon. Es muy fuerte. Simia sobrepasa cero porque tiene más alto que el otro. Es muy fuerte esto del tener. Y del estar en, y de este aloti tan misterioso. ¿Qué es el aloti? Bueno, hay alguna cosa, no sé si jugarme como hacía cuando era joven a pensar que había una tercera entidad. Bueno, tal vez Sedley lo dijo, habló de los, ¿cómo lo llamó? Essential Beings. Él se animó, pero bueno, él tiene tiene derecho. Pero bueno, me parece que dentro de este fuerte lenguaje de la inmanencia hay un cambio de registro. Me parece que junto con este no comprometerse demasiado con la relación, se usa la homonimia, que le da a Platón cierta libertad, no le implica ningún compromiso. Pero en el marco del último argumento, cuando aumenta tan fuertemente el lenguaje de la inmanencia, es notable que ahí usa eponimia, Lo que pasa es que esta cuestión Platón no la tematiza, como la cuestión de los contrarios, que tampoco la tematiza y la usa. Y los detalles vienen después. Aristóteles es el que se ocupa de sistematizar todas las cuestiones que encuentra en Platón, y algunas lo sigue y otras no, y bueno, y es cierto que Platón no hizo un detalle ni una teoría sobre esto que pueda darnos pistas, pero a mí me pareció como llamativo, ¿no?, este cambio de denominación de la relación de homónimos a epónimos, con lo que eso implica, ¿no?
Tenemos solamente 3 minutos y una pregunta muy cortita y una respuesta también.
Gaby, quería preguntarte si, así como siguiendo con la cuestión de los essential bearers, de los que ayer habló Sedley, si te parece que esta reflexión o intuición platónica, que es una intuición ontológica también, tiene algún reflejo en la ontología platónica de la vejez.
Y la tripartición después aparece con fuerza en el Timeo, ¿no? Es notable que aparece en el Fedón, después en el Parménides. Todo esto se critica, parece que las formas no pudieran explicar y la relación de participación fuera imposible. Y después en el Timeo se vuelven a aparecer las formas, pero además es claramente tripartito. Y lo que entra en la jora no son las ideas, sino que hay otra cosa que entra en la jora, que son las mimémata de las ideas. Entonces, es tripartito. Y ahí sí que en el Timeo se propone explicar esta cuestión. Se propone explicar la cuestión de los particulares que están jugando ahí atrás y que están jugando siempre en toda la obra, para mí. Pero ahí claramente están las mimématas que entran y que salen, los particulares quedarían reducidos a esas inflamaciones de la jora y la jora. Entonces ahí la tripartición es muy fuerte y muy detallada. Si ven acá por ahí, en el Fedón está más en germen o más implícita, en el Timeo es claro.
Bueno, muchas gracias, estamos en tiempo. Ahora vamos, now we proceed to Professor Lenka Karpikova.
Ratio, Augustine's criticism of the final proof in Plato's Phaedo. I had to shorten drastically my paper, but I hope you can follow the codes, the text I have analyzed. It cannot, unfortunately, be established with certainty whether Augustine knew Plato's dialogue Phaedo, and if he did, to what extent and through whose mediation. It is usually no longer maintained that he read the now lost translation by Apuleius, as Prosper Alfaric argued at the beginning of the 20th century. I skipped the introduction. No, thank you. I skipped the introduction to the last paragraph. One clear borrowing from the Phaedo, which probably does not draw on Cicero, is Augustine's polemic against the final proof of the immortality of the soul from this dialogue, which I would like to discuss here. So the first part, the soul as the bearer of life, Augustine's polemic in the Soliloquies. According to Plato, the soul is inseparably linked with life, and thus it does not accept death, in the same way as the fire is defined by the form of heat, echeideten ekeinu morthen aie, which is why it does not accept cold. If something contains an idea in this way, it can never accept its opposite. Instead, it ceases to exist or goes away. Etoi apolumena hyp ekorunta. That is why the soul, being linked with life, does not accept death, but either perishes or withdraws. If, however, the soul does not accept death, then it is immortal, athanatos, and thus imperishable, anoletros. It cannot perish when death approaches, but goes away instead. So far, Plato's Phaedo. In the Soliloquies, one of his earliest works from the Cassiciacum period, Augustine comments on this proof, stating that perhaps the soul does not accept death while it lasts, but it may eventually perish in the same way as the light does not admit darkness into itself while it lasts, but it may still go out. This objection, which was probably first formulated by Strato of Lampsacus, a peripatetic philosopher, does not seem to be aimed at the immortality of the soul itself, but against the cogency of the Platonic argumentation. As Augustine puts it, I quote, it is the footnote number 14 in the written text of my paper, from Soliloquies. I say rather that the soul can cease to exist, but by the very fact of dying. And I am not dissuaded from believing this by the statement of great philosophers that the reality which gives life, wherever it goes, cannot admit death into itself. For even thought that life creates brightness wherever it goes and cannot admit darkness because of the remarkable force of opposites, nevertheless, it can be put out and the place is darkened when the light is extinguished. And so, that which resisted the darkness and did not admit darkness into itself made place for the darkness by perishing, just as it could make place for it by departing. So I am afraid that death might happen to the body in the same way as darkness comes to a place that is either by the soul going away as light might move away or by being extinguished. End quote from Soliloquies. Augustine thus argues that the death of the body does not make it possible to establish whether the soul which animated it departed, discedente animo, without perishing, as Plato would have it, or was extinguished, extincto, just as the light might be, although it does not admit darkness while it shines. Plato's analogy of a fire which is linked with heat and thus does not accept cold is transposed by Augustine into an analogy of light, which does not accept darkness while shining. The soul's resistance to death, states Augustine, definitely lasts while the soul lasts, but it does not guarantee that the soul will not exhaust itself in the same way as the light, it is fire, goes out. In his proof, Plato makes a clear distinction between the two cases. The fire, bearing the form of heat, does not admit cold, as its opposite. Its end, however, is not the opposite of heat. On the contrary, the soul, as the bearer of life, does not admit death as the opposite of life, and as such is immortal and thus imperishable. What Augustine has in mind in his polemics is a specific light. It is a specific fire, probably not the light of the stars, for instance, which can obviously be put out or goes out by itself after it has consumed its fuel. The clear distinction which Plato saw between this case and the soul, which is linked with life, it is with the idea of life, autototes, zoes, eidos, and as such does not admit its opposite in the sense of dying or perishing, was disregarded by Augustine. Augustine does not seem to presuppose any idea of life, and the logical trick, if I may say so, of Plato's argument seems to escape or disinterest him. Whichever the case was, Augustine did not link the proof with Plato or Plato alone, but with the authority of great philosophers. This reference very probably suggests the Neoplatonic origin of the idea as Augustine knew it. So let's have a look at them. The soul as life, which lives of itself, Plotinus and Porphyry. In his treatise on the immortality of the soul, it is the Aeneid 4.7, Plotinus does indeed make use of Plato's proof. Like Augustine after him, Plotinus recognizes the danger that the fire to which the soul is compared here may go out. However, he does not go on to reach such a pessimistic conclusion as Augustine. On the contrary, he shows the limitations of Plato's analogy. According to Plotinus, the soul does not underlie as a bearer in the sense of matter into which the life comes from the outside, in the same way as the fire sets alight the underlying matter. It is the quote in the footnote number 17 in my written paper. In his detachment from Plato's analogy, Plotinus, in fact, identifies the soul with life, though with, not with life borrowed from another, in the way the body is animated by the soul, but with life as a substance, ousia, which lives of itself, par autes zosa. This motive does not appear in Plato himself. According to his account in the Phaedo, the soul bears life, as we know. But it is not stated here that the soul has life of itself or that it is identical with life or its idea. Plotinus's interpretation, replacing the connection of the soul with the idea of life by its life of itself, does not draw solely on the Phaedo, but also on the notion of the soul as the origin of motion from Plato's Phaedrus. You have the quote in the footnote number 20. I skip the rest of Plotinus, going to Porphyry. Like Plotinus, Porphyry is also familiar with the idea of the soul as living of itself, par heautes, as we can read in his sentence number 17. It is the footnote number 25. In another passage of sentences, Porphyry makes it clear that the life in question is not adopted from the outside, exoten, but originates in the soul, souls themselves, par he auton. For this reason, souls do not succumb to living or not living, but live by necessity. Only things composed of matter and form can perish, according to Porphyry, but not the soul. This is what Plato meant, Porphyry says, by his teaching on the soul as self-motion. It is the quote in footnote number 26. Porphyry thus explicitly replaces the link between the soul and the idea of life by defining it as self-motion, to autokineton. He regards the soul as a being which has its life from itself. This motive does not appear in Augustine's formulation of the proof. Similarly to Plato, Augustine merely posits the soul as a bearer of life. It is not identical with it, and neither does it have it from itself. Nor does Augustine make the link to the idea of the soul as the origin of motion from Plato's Phaedrus. The only thing which connects his argumentation with the Neoplatonic one is Plotinus's remark concerning the fact that a fire might go out when it runs out of fuel. However, the ways in which the motive is employed by both authors are quite different, as we have seen already. Moreover, neither Plotinus nor Porphyry makes use of the analogy of light, which resists darkness as long as it shines. As this analogy has no parallel in Plato's account either, it may remind the reader of the prologue of the fourth gospel, in which the light shines in the darkness and the darkness did not overcome it. Augustine, however, does not refer to this passage, a biblical passage, but to the remarkable force of the opposites, propter memorabilem illam vim contrariorum, which again is a motive which links him with Plato himself, rather than with his Neoplatonic interpreters. On the other end, as far as the force proof from Plato's Phaedo is concerned, a certain variant of this argument can also be found in Augustine's Christian teacher, Ambrose of Milan, who in his De Bono Mortis identifies the soul with life and approves Plato's demonstration. I skip Ambrose, unfortunately, just saying that it is not clear whether or not Augustine had known the written version of this sermon, De Bono Mortis, while writing his soliloquies. But it is clear enough that this sermon by Ambrose could not have been the only source of his knowledge of Plato's proof. First, Augustine's version of Plato is much more faithful to the original than that of Ambrose. And second, Augustine would hardly have referred to the Bishop of Milan as great philosophers if he had been his only source. The next part, the soul as life, which does not discern itself, Augustine's proof in the Immortalitate Animae. The issue of Augustine's sources is complicated as ever, and things are even worse by the fact that the soliloquies is not Augustine's final word concerning Plato's proof. In the work which immediately followed the soliloquies and was meant as a kind of sequel, it is in the outline De Immortalitate Anime, Augustine himself gives, among other things, a proof which is very similar to the one he rejected in the soliloquies. Similarly to the Neoplatonic predecessors and Ambrose of Milan, Augustine now, unlike in his soliloquies, identifies the soul and life. A life could only leave the soul if it were animate, it is, if the soul were not life itself. If the soul and life are one, then the soul does not die. It is the quote in footnote number 36. Here Augustine makes a distinction between life itself and what is endowed with life. It is living, or literally animate, animato. This distinction does not appear in Ambrose, but it can be found in a version very similar to that of Augustine in another Latin Platonist, Calcidius, who draws it from Plato's Phaedrus. I skip Calcidius as well. Going back to Augustine, still in his De Immortalitate, Augustine makes an explicit identification of the soul and life so that he could draw his conclusion regarding the immortality of the soul as follows. I quote, it is the footnote number 39 in my paper. "For if the soul, says Augustine, dies when life deserts it, it is much better to understand the life which goes away as soul, so that the soul is not that which is deserted by life, but the life itself which goes away. For anything which is deserted by life and called that is understood to have been deserted by the soul. And so the life which deserts the thing which die is itself the soul, and it does not desert itself. Consequently, the soul does not die." It is not clear whether, and if so, why Augustine changed his mind in the Immortalitate Anime regarding the plausibility of the false proof for Plato's Phaedo. It might seem that it was facilitated by the identification of the soul with life as it appears in the Neoplatonic authors as well as Ambrose. It is true that what makes both of Augustine's paraphrases different, among others, is the lack of this motive in the first one, it is in the soliloquies. On the other hand, the objection raised by Augustine in his soliloquies is still valid. Even if the soul is identified with the life which goes away, one cannot be certain whether it actually just goes away, as the Platonic proof would have it, and is not extinguished after all. Augustine does not argue against the soul's being extinguished by identifying with it with life which lives of itself, but by claiming that this life does not desert itself, say ipsam non deserit. This line of argumentation is missing not only in his soliloquies, but also in Plato's Phaedo, and it is not to be found in the Neoplatonic interpreters in this context either. On the other hand, it appears in Plato's Phaedrus, as well as in Cicero's paraphrase of this cosmological proof of the immortality of the soul as the beginning of motion. Here, too, the soul does not leave itself. Uc apolepon he auto, num quam deseritur a se. Unfortunately, in none of these authors it is clear what the phrase actually means. For this reason, I turn to a paraphrase which appeared much later in the 10th book of Augustine's De Trinitate, in which he summarized again the Platonic notion of the soul and the Platonic attempt at proving its immortality. I quote from De Trinitate. Others, it is the footnote number 46, others, however, found the substance of mind to be life, seeing that it is life that animates and vivifies every living body. These tried, as best as each of them could, to prove that mind is immortal, since life cannot lack life. presumably, end quote, presumably the phrase life cannot lack life, vita carere vita non potest, is the equivalent of Augustine's wording from his account in the Immortalitate, this life does not desert itself, se ipsam non deserit. As is also quite evident from its late paraphrase in De Trinitate, it is this argument which Augustine regards as crucial in the Platonic proof. What Augustine might mean here is that life does not abandon the soul because it is identical with the soul in its very substance. In order for this argument to escape his objection from the soliloquies, Augustine would also have to tacitly maintain the Neoplatonic concept of the soul as life, which lives of itself. In other words, he would have to maintain that the soul does not merely borrow its life from another because it would be bound to lose it again, and thus lack or abandon itself. However, I do not believe that Augustine ever made this option. Another possibility would be that although Augustine mentioned this proof, he does not regard it as quite convincing. In my opinion, this alternative is the most probable one. It is clear in the context of the passage of De Trinitate quoted above that Augustine does not attach much weight to the Platonic proof. Instead, he is trying to show that the rational soul, mens, consists above all in the knowledge of itself, as Augustine puts it. The rational soul is to be certain that it is only that which it is certain of to be. It is self-knowledge, though it may take the form of doubt. This is the only thing of which the mind is certain. Therefore, this is the only thing it is, and it is such in its substance itself, substantia. Instead of describing it as a life which does not abandon itself, Augustine presents the soul as a mind which is related to itself through its self-knowledge, and is thus certain of itself. One may arrive at a similar conclusion after reading the account in the Immortalitate Anime from Augustine's youth. Even thought self-knowledge plays no important role there. Not even in his early account does Augustine attribute any crucial role to the Platonic proof about the soul as life which does not abandon itself. His own arguments are somewhat different. They are concerned with the rationality of the soul as the basis of its immortality. In my opinion, there are essentially two proofs in the Immortalitate following two possible relationships between the soul and ratio. First, if the eternal ratio is in the soul, which is its beer, then the soul cannot perish. And second, if the ratio and the soul are two substances, the soul cannot be separated from the eternal ratio, which is why the soul cannot perish. What is important here is the overall purpose of Augustine's argumentation. He tries to show that the soul is not immortal as the principle which animates the body, but mainly because of its relationship to the immortal ratio. Similarly, in the soliloquies, the immortality of the soul was eventually derived from the immortality of the truth, which can be found in the soul. So I have to skip the conclusion, just read the last paragraph. Nevertheless, it is obvious that what matters to Augustine in his proofs is the immortality of the rational soul, not the indestructibility of the principle of cosmic life. It seems to be this factor which makes Augustine approach with a certain caution the Platonic proof of the immortality of the soul as the beer of life. Thank you.
Ich erlaube mir auf Deutsch zu fragen, ja. Vielleicht. Und zwar habe ich eigentlich zwei Fragen. Und zwar zum einen eine ganz allgemeine. Und zwar ist Augustinus ja jemand, der doch relativ stark selbst reflektiert. Auch in seinen späteren Werken, man hat ja dann noch die Retraktatio Meditation ist und so fort. Und gibt es da irgendwelche Hinweise dazu, darauf, was er oder wie er selbst die vielleicht fehlende Argumentation oder die fehlende Beweiskraft der Argumentation versteht oder merkt er selber seine Unterschiede oder merkt er selber die Unterschiede, die er in der Argumentation vornimmt? Das wäre die erste Frage. Und die zweite Frage würde sich darauf beziehen, inwiefern Augustinus ja seine, also er hat ja seine Seelenlehre selber auch noch, ich sag mal, überarbeitet. Das heißt, er kommt ja eigentlich aus diesem sehr platonischen, breit geteilten Seelenmodell, wenn ich mich recht erinnere, und geht dann über in, ja, vielleicht eher wieder diesen, ja, phädonischen Körper-Seele-Dualismus. Also er ändert ja auch seine Seelenlehre. Ich bin mir nicht mal ganz sicher, aber ich meine, ich habe das mal so gelesen. Und würde sich dadurch dann in der Argumentation für ihn etwas, oder ändert, ist die Argumentation für seine frühe Seelenlehre eine andere als für seine späte Seelenlehre? Gäbe es da eventuell fehlende Brücken oder so?
Ja, vielen Dank, Felix, wenn ich auf Deutsch anfangen darf. Das ist eigentlich eine Frage. Augustinus hat zwar in diesem Punkt seine Meinung, ich weiß nicht, ob er wirklich seine Meinung geändert hat. Ich meine, er hat eigentlich nie diesen Beweis, den vierten Beweis aus Phaidon, sehr ernst genommen. Ich meine, ihm war eigentlich immer die Verbindung von Seele und Ratio oder Seele und Wahrheit Seele und Denken, wenn man so will, wichtiger als die Verbindung mit Leben. Ich denke, ja, das war wirklich deswegen, weil für ihn bloß die vernünftige, die intellektuelle Seele unsterblich ist. Und er hat selber, soviel ich weiß, die Entwicklung nicht reflektiert, weil, wie ich gesagt habe, es war ihm wahrscheinlich nicht so wichtig. Auch in der Immortalität, er hat eigentlich mehrere Beweise und mehrere Möglichkeiten. Und diese ist eigentlich eher am Rande. Und man bemerkt, dass da ein Unterschied ist. Den Soliloquien gegenüber, aber es ist ihm nicht so wichtig, würde ich sagen. Und was für seine spätere Entwicklung angeht, was er sieht selber, dass die Seele eigentlich viel schwächer ist, als die Platoniker es so denken und als er selber am Anfang seiner Karriere es gedacht hat. Er dachte am Anfang, wie Plotinus auch oder Porphyrius, dass die Seele unveränderlich ist, zum Beispiel. Und in der Immortalität selber, in der Schrift selber, hat er seine Meinung geändert. Also ich meine, am Anfang sagt er das noch, aber dann sagt er, ja, es ist eigentlich nicht so. Und dieses Bewusstsein der nicht nur epistemologischen, sondern auch ontologischen Schwäche der Seele ist eigentlich immer stärker und stärker in Augustinus. Zu dieser Frage kommt er meines Erachtens oder meines Wissens nicht mehr zurück, bloß in der Trinitate, wo er eigentlich mehrere Möglichkeiten, wie man die Seele verstehen kann, aufzählt und die Platoniker in diesem Katalog sozusagen. Aber wiederum, es ist ihm nicht so wichtig. Also es ist merkwürdig, aber es ist irgendwie, er hat seinen Abstand dazu. Wenn man jetzt das Argument selber anguckt, und ich meine, er hat eigentlich nie die Kritik von Strato von Lampsacus verlassen. Er hat es wahrscheinlich immer noch als etwas Ernstes angesehen. Aber hat tatsächlich dann die Seele mit dem Leben identifiziert, was in den Soliloquien noch nicht der Fall war. Aber ob das eine so große Änderung gebracht hat, das ist mir eine Frage, weil in seinen Augen war das Argument immer noch nicht haltbar oder immer noch nicht valid eigentlich. Es sei denn, es wäre das Leben, wie die Neuplatoniker es verstanden haben, das aus sich selbst lebt. Aber das hat er nie gesagt. Also ich meine, eine gewisse Entwicklung ist da schon, aber die ist wahrscheinlich nicht so wichtig.
Ich habe drei Minuten mehr für eine Frage.
Thank you for your interesting paper. I want to know the difference between Augustine and Plato's concept of life. So for Plato, life is characterized not only as rationality, but also as living in the polis, right? Polis. But in Augustine's case, life is related to the Roman Empire, I think. So living in the polis and living in the Roman Empire may be different. So it, do you think this difference works to explain their similarities and differences with respect to their notion of life?
I think what Augustine prevents from saying that soul is life, living of itself, as the his Neoplatonic predecessor, was a kind of religious cautious. He said it is God who is life of lives, life of souls. So in this sense, the life, in fact, was not so much really, even if identified with soul, soul is not its source, its last source, which is in fact the same thing as in the Neoplatonic philosophers. I think he is in fact very close to them. In Plotinus, you have life in almost in all levels of his universe. Even in the intellect, there is a life whose source is not soul. That is quite evident. It is a kind of combination of diversity in unity. So it is in fact life in the intellect. And then at the level of soul and nature, there maybe it is soul which is the source. It is not the body or something, but it is soul bringing life into this realm. It seems to be very similar in fact in Augustine. The soul also is not the last source of life, it is just a beer of life or something. But as has been already said in the discussion, the soul is weaker for Augustine than for his Neoplatonic predecessor. The soul is not so much a citizen of the intellectual world like in Plotinus, so it is much weaker.
Thank you very much for your nice presentation and sticking to time. Now we proceed to the next speaker, Matthew Walker.
Can they hear me in TV land? Okay. Thank you, Idrisi, and thanks to the organizers of this symposium. I've learned a lot this week, and on the topic of symposia, I'm going to be presenting a paper called Socrates' Final Symposium, which is very much a work in progress, and I'll be reading it. And what follows, I sketch the outline of a revisionary reading of the aims of Plato's Phaedo. On traditional readings, the dialogue provides Socrates' defense of the soul's unqualified immortality, that is, the soul's capacity for eternal existence in a as a numerically identical individual in postmortem separation from the body. On such traditional readings, Socrates aims to fulfill Cebes' demand that he show that the soul still exists after a man has died and that it still possesses some capability and intelligence. I agree that the Phaedo, through the figure of Socrates, endorses the thought that we are potentially immortal. But the sort of immortality that Socrates endorses, I argue, is only the qualified immortality that he explicitly defends in the symposium, that is, a mortal soul's capacity to persist post-mortem in an extended sense through reproduction. The Phaedo's arguments fail, I suggest, because Socrates wishes to steer his interlocutors toward, and because Plato wishes to remind his readers of, this other kind of immortality. Socrates, is having taken steps to immortalize himself in this sense, better explains his justified equanimity in the face of death. Consider the multiple ways in which Plato links the Phaedo dramatically with this symposium.
In both works, events that happened many years ago, Socrates' last hours in the Phaedo, Agathon's party in the symposium, are preserved by the rehearsal of those whom Socrates deeply influenced. More significantly, both works are crucially centered around drinking. The point is clear enough in the symposium's case, but in the Phaedo, reference to Socrates' drinking the potion initially appears in the dialogue's opening line. In his final moments, Socrates treats the potion as akin to wine, his death as a drinking party. He asks the guard, "What do you say about pouring a libation from this drink? Is it allowed?" Yes. Uniquely in both works, Socrates shows up bathed to his special events. In both of these events, women who otherwise never appear in Platonic dialogues are sent away. Instead of depicting ordinary symposia, Plato describes relatively sober affairs that emphasize logoi over intemperate drinking, eating, and sex. At Agathon's party, so too at Socrates' execution, Socrates stays moderate while drinking and courageous when facing the cold. And if Phaedo Socrates should prove immortal, then he once more shows himself impervious to the effects of drink. Anne-Marie Schultz, in her paper the other day, had some observations I thought were interesting about the ways in which Socrates echoes Diotima in various ways in his conversations with Simisocides. Just a side point from this week. Reading the Phaedo through the lens of the symposium, reading the Phaedo as a symposium, as Socrates' final symposium, promises us a new understanding of the Phaedo's views on immortality and on Socrates' equanimity in the face of death. It also plays other interpretive dividends. In his discussion with Simmias and Cebes, Socrates discusses multiple arguments for the unqualified immortality of the soul. Given time constraints, I lack space to address each of these arguments individually, yet I'll just throw out a bold conjecture. I contend that each of these arguments fails to meet the hopes of Socrates' interlocutors, and that Plato is aware of their failure, for each of these arguments faces problems that emerge more or less explicitly within the dialogue itself. I have a long footnote 9 going through those arguments kind of quickly. I'll just bracket that point for now. Assume then, for the purposes of this paper, that my bold conjecture is right. Why then does Plato give space to these arguments? In the Phaedo's dramatic context, Socrates faces the demand to defend his equanimity in the face of looming death. For the anxious Simmias and Cebes assume that Socrates is justified in so facing death only if Socrates can show that the soul is immortal without qualification. Unless one has proof of the soul's unqualified immortality, they contend, one is foolish to be confident when death approaches. This assumption, however, is problematic. It displays and is motivated by an excessive clinging to life and a childish fear of death. Worse still, if it turns out, as seems likely, that we cannot prove the soul's unqualified immortality, this assumption threatens to produce mythology, the worst evil of all. By presenting these arguments for immortality, I suggest, Socrates provides Simmias and Cebes a kind of therapeutic space in which they can begin, safely to re-examine some of their taken for granted views about how one may properly confront death with equanimity and thereby quell their fears about death. More specifically, Socrates aims to confront Simmias and Cebes with the initially disquieting but ultimately liberating possibility that human beings may well not be unqualifiedly immortal. For Simmias and Cebes are like sailors on a windless sea. If they assume that the only way to sail forward with justified equanimity is with wind, that is, with the assurance of the soul's unqualified immortality, then a lack of wind, that is, their lack of such assurance, invites despair. But such sailors, like Simmias and Cebes, can also reconsider their assumptions. They can consider otherwise overlooked alternatives. They can embark on a second sailing, using oars, that is, different logoi. Socrates invokes just this second sailing metaphor when recounting his own dashed hopes at Anaxagorean natural philosophy's failure to resolve his questions about the causes of generation and good arrangement in the cosmos. Socrates confronts Simmias and Cebes with a full range of arguments for immortality, and he allows the weaknesses of these arguments to bubble to the surface. By revealing that his interlocutors lack any good reason to accept that human beings possess unqualified immortality, Socrates compels Simmias and Cebes to face their basic options. On the one hand, they can conclude that equanimity in the face of death is unjustified for anyone, and that despair is the only proper outlook. On the other hand, they can open themselves to the possibility, which their excessive hopes for unqualified immortality have led them either to overlook or repress, that justified equanimity may well be possible even if one lacks unqualified immortality. The various arguments for immortality then serve as charms for Simmias and Cebes to begin to relieve their fears. As Socrates' interlocutors think through them and come to see their limitations, they are in a position gradually to free themselves from the anxiety and mythology-conducive assumption that the only way to face death with justified equanimity is to have proof of unqualified immortality. In the Frame dialogue, Plato recounts to Echecrates how those assembled with Socrates faced despair when they first came to realize these arguments' limitations. But Phaedo affirms that Socrates was able to enact a cure. At the end of the Phaedo, Socrates' other mourners begin the task of working through Socrates' logoi. To this extent, they, and those of the rest of us who read the Phaedo, can ultimately be healed from closed-mindedness about how one may justifiably face death with equanimity. To the extent that they and we have resources for considering alternatives, Socrates believes it's fitting to owe a cock to Asclepius. So if contrary to the various arguments discussed in the Phaedo, we lack any proof of our unqualified immortality, then what can justify equanimity in the face of death? What second ceiling is available to Simmias, Cebes, and Socrates' other friends? My proposal: once freed from a fixation on unqualified immortality, Simmias and Cebes are open to consider and to pursue the prospects of a qualified immortality. One attains such immortality through reproduction, which enables one to leave behind replacements for oneself. I think this is the view in the symposium. Such is the immortality that Diotima assures Socrates is the only kind available for mortal nature. Such a conception rules out unqualified immortality. Still, it allows a living being to attain an immortal possession of the good as far as possible by generating offspring. In the case of human beings, some people are pregnant in body and attain a qualified immortality by generating biological children. Others, by contrast, are more pregnant in soul and attain a qualified immortality by generating progeny of a more perfect kind. Among those more pregnant in soul, Diotima suggests, philosophers attain a qualified immortality most fully. Perhaps Professor Kaneyama will disagree with me on the qualified nature of this immortality, but that's another point. They possess the good immortally as far as possible, not by propagating mere images of virtue, but by propagating true virtue. That is, what is truly good about themselves, and by winning the love of the gods. Philosophers, as Diotima suggests, can propagate true virtue by making a spiritual ascent from merely bodily concerns and by pursuing the higher mysteries that bring them to a glimpse of beauty itself, the cause of all particular beauties. In the Phaedo, Socrates holds that those philosophizing in the right way practice dying. Socrates notes, however, this description of philosophers is ambiguous. Socrates' ultimate view, I suggest, goes as follows. Those who philosophize correctly practice dying by philosophizing in this life. On the one hand, such philosophers draw virtuous and happy, thereby live fully and well in the stretch of time leading up to their physical deaths, that is, in the living that is, from another perspective, a dying also. On the other hand, physical death does not bring about their final end. On the contrary, their valuable features persist beyond their physical deaths in the virtues that they generate and nurture in others, and in turn, in any virtues that these others generate in others still. In both ways, philosophers possess the good immortally as far as anyone humanly can. Hence, philosophers have the most justification of anyone for equanimity in the face of death. Does any evidence, however, show that the Phaedo Socrates endorses the symposium's turn to qualified immortality, and that he thinks such immortality supports the philosopher's justified equanimity? Does he offer his friends any conceptual resources, any oars, for moving forward? The answer, I think, is yes. A. In the conversation in which Socrates explains why philosophy is a practice of dying, Socrates endorses 3 points learned from Diotima. First, the philosopher displays eros, not for bodies, but for thoughtfulness and wisdom. Second, the philosopher thus attains a kind of freedom from a certain enslavement to the body and disdains a certain body-obsessed way of life, a way of life organized around the pleasures of clothing, money, and sex. Third, wisdom in turn enables the philosopher to attain true virtue as opposed to mere paintings or imitations of virtue. True, Simmias understands that second point about the soul's liberation from the body differently from how I take Socrates to intend it. Simmias construes that second point as a metaphysical claim about the soul's existential separability from the body, whereas I read Socrates' claim about the philosophical soul's separability as having an ethical sense. In this latter sense, philosophers separate their souls from their bodies by freeing themselves from a base way of life organized around gratifying bodily desires. But Plato foregrounds the possibility that what Socrates means by the soul's separability differs from his interlocutor's own understanding, for again, Socrates begins his exchange with Simmias by explicitly highlighting ambiguities of the claim that philosophers practice dying and death. B, consider the conversation that immediately precedes the arguments for immortality. Here Socrates' remarks recall Diotima's language of the mysteries in the symposium's account of the philosopher's ascent. Thus, Socrates expresses his confidence that insofar as one is initiated in the mysteries, one can die well and live with the gods. There are indeed, Socrates says, as those concerned with the mysteries, many who carry the thyrsus, but the bacchants are few. These latter are, in my opinion, no other than those who have practiced philosophy in the right way. I have in my life left nothing undone in order to be counted among these as far as possible, as I have been eager to be in every way. Socrates' reference to the thyrsus, a traditional fertility symbol in the mysteries, recalls his views on pregnancy in the symposium. Only philosophers ascend to the higher mysteries and bring their psychic pregnancy, true virtue, to full term. Here, Socrates affirms that he's done all he can to be generative in this way. Hence, he can die peacefully. C, when Socrates, Simmias, and Cebes discuss the initial arguments for immortality, Socrates subtly slips themes from Diotima's speech into these arguments. He thus prepares Simmias and Cebes to think more fully through how generation, eros, beauty, and immortality interrelate. First, the argument from opposites, for instance, links something's being immortal with its participating in cycles of generation. This argument suggests that all life, in some way at least, may thereby have some access to a certain immortality. Second, in the argument from recollection, Socrates introduces the notion of recollection by indicating that lovers recollect the boys they love erotically by reference to the lyres, garments, and other items that such boys use. Third, the argument from affinity distinguishes particular sensible beauties which are subject to change from beauty itself, which is not, in ways I think we call the symposium's description of beauty itself. Further, the argument makes a crucial point that the symposium develops independently. To the extent that the soul is like such a form, to the extent that the soul becomes truly beautiful, to that extent the soul is apt to attain a kind of immortality, albeit of a qualified sort. D, in his intellectual autobiography, Socrates invites his interlocutors to consider the cause of generation and destruction. Socrates recounts his old hopes that natural philosophy might reveal an account of what such processes occur. But despite their occasionally tantalizing reference to mind, which to Socrates initially seemed capable of arranging all things for the best, figures such as Anaxagoras could not supply Socrates the sort of explanations that seemed necessary. To explain fitting arrangement in the cosmos, Socrates discovered one must invoke teleological principles instead of merely material mechanistic ones. In the symposium, however, Socrates identifies just the sort of teleological principle capable of causing all generation. This principle turns out to be beauty itself, the ultimate object of eros. Beauty itself serves as an ultimate cause of fitting arrangement, that is beauty throughout the cosmos. In the Phaedo, Socrates invokes this view in his prelude to the argument from forms of the final argument. There he identifies his turn to forms as his own second sailing, and he reiterates his belief that beauty itself is the cause of beauty in all beautiful things. E, the Phaedo's concluding myth develops a self-consciously symbolic description of qualified immortality open to the philosopher through the pursuit of wisdom and true virtue in this life. Socrates explicitly emphasizes the myth's non-literal character at 114b. With this myth, Socrates exhorts his friends not to give up on philosophy. If we propagate vice in this life, both in ourselves and in others, we attain a surrogate postmortem existence akin to being cast into Tartarus. If, by contrast, we cultivate true virtue in this life, we can attain a kind of surrogate happiness in the afterlife, for the virtue we propagate in this life can persist after our physical deaths and will enable us in a qualified, metaphorical way to occupy a beautiful dwelling, this beautiful prize of pursuing wisdom and virtue is fitting, for by adorning the soul with virtue in this life, we prepare ourselves well for the afterlife. We persist in the virtues, we can thereby nurture in others. Thus, F, Socrates asks his friends to care for themselves as a favor to him, to his own, and to themselves. Socrates' very final words to his gathered friends are an admonishment: do not be careless. He thereby hopes to secure his efforts to secure to attain a qualified, or choice-worthy qualified immortality through his ethical progeny. Plato portrays those attending Socrates' death as, in a sense, Socrates' children. Plato recalls to Echecrates, we all felt as if we had lost a father and would be orphaned for the rest of our lives. As if highlighting the ways in which Socrates immortalizes himself reproductively, Plato immediately follows Phaedo's remark with the vignette of Socrates saying goodbye to his three biological sons. Although Socrates will die, he nevertheless lives on in an extended sense through his biological and ethical children, and most fully in the virtue that he has nurtured in the latter. Socrates himself passes away, yet he persists in a qualified form in the next generation. At the same time, the way that Plato introduces Socrates' biological children indicates the superiority of the qualified immortality attainable for Socrates through his ethical children. Earlier in the dialogue, Socrates' wife Xanthippe makes her sole appearance in the Platonic dialogues, holding their baby. Socrates' impending death devastates her, as her wailing, lamenting, and breastfeeding suggest. Thus, Socrates sends her away, as he later says, to avoid such unseemliness. Xanthippe's response to Socrates' death mirrors that of Socrates' mad disciple Apollodorus. Although not an attendee at Agathon's symposium, Apollodorus recounts the events that transpired there, and he now shows up at Socrates' final symposium. As Socrates drinks the potion, Apollodorus cries noisily and rages at Socrates' death. Socrates chastises Apollodorus for his inability to control himself. The behavior of Xanthippe and Apollodorus deserves notice. On the one hand, these characters do engage reproductively with Socrates. Whereas Xanthippe gives birth to Socrates' biological children, Apollodorus, by rehearsing the story of what happened at Agathon's symposium, exhibits the mechanism by which reproduction preserves, namely by replacing what is old with something new. While the Apophido portrays Xanthippe in a respectful light, the dialogues linking Xanthippe with Apollodorus suggest a shortcoming in Xanthippe and Apollodorus. Like Apollodorus, Xanthippe seems trapped in an all-too-exclusive love of individual people. The similarly excessive responses of Apollodorus and Xanthippe to Socrates' death dramatize these characters' failure to make the philosopher's ascent. These characters' tendency toward harshness elsewhere suggests this failure. Such harshness appears more fully in other symposia. Apollodorus is in the Symposium of Plato, Xanthippe is in the Symposium of Plato's contemporary Xenophon. Let me just wrap up here. Is my revisionary reading of Plato, of the Phaedo's aims and arguments, willfully perverse? No. One, again, by common consent, the Phaedo's arguments for unqualified immortality all fail. Moreover, Plato himself seems to be aware of their failure. Lest we read Plato uncharitably, then, we should doubt that Plato himself accepts these arguments. Two, my approach does not attribute any excessively esoteric agenda to Plato. On the contrary, my approach holds that Plato accepts a certain view that Socrates explicitly expounds, namely the one in the Symposium. Third, my approach is committed to the view that Plato accepts the two pillars of Platonism. It just understands them a little differently from the way we might usually understand them. Finally, if we're doubtful about the prospects of unqualified immortality, then an added advantage of my approach is that it need not saddle Plato with that view. Thank you.
Hi, man. I do think it's woefully perverse, but I guess there's a lot of questions I could ask, but One, what do you take of, after the final immortality argument, the way in which Cabes, who seemed to have been the sharper interlocutor, accepts the argument, and he's been skeptical up to that point. A lot of people take that as a sign that Plato wants us to think that this is a good argument. And then soon after that, we have Socrates saying, it would be such a blessing to the wicked if souls weren't immortal. And that seems to require genuine, real, life after death sort of immortality. And so what do you make of so there's sort of two things after the final immortality argument that seem to suggest we want genuine immortality. And then let me just mention a very different sort of thing. Why think that we should be doing what's humanly, what's appropriate for humans? Because there's no indication within the Phaedo that we are humans. We are our souls. Those souls occasionally take on human form. The body is more akin to the human, whereas the soul is more akin to the divine. So there's a very consistent, we aren't humans, we are souls. So why would we expect us to be doing the things which are human? So there's the two questions.
Thanks. There are three questions there. The first one would require me to address the final argument. I think there is, so when I say that I don't think the arguments go through, that is, I don't think they go through in the sense of establishing unqualified immortality. There is something important about that final argument that I think is right? It shows that souls are essential bearers, which seems to be the term that we're all using, sadly, essential bearers of life. That shows that souls are, in an important way, different from heaps of snow or toasters or any other things, which cannot be immortal, right? Those other items cannot be immortal because they are not essential bearers of life. So souls, at least, are essential bearers of life. Now, if it turns out, hence, in some sense, they are deathless. Now, if what is deathless is indestructible, then the soul is indestructible. But as Socrates is very explicit, if not, we need another argument. And so I think that does suffice in some way to show that the soul is immortal, albeit in a qualified way. The other argument that we have would be, I take it, the one from Diotima. So I think there's something sophisticated about that argument, and that's right to a certain extent. It just might not be exactly what Eusebius himself has in mind. On the second point I would have to review the passage, but thought is it would be a blessing to the wicked if the soul did perish. I take it that maybe at least one way in which the wicked do persist post-mortem is in the bad reputations they leave behind. And so for that reason, I think it would be maybe a blessing if they could perish altogether. I need to take a look at that. And I guess what I could say is, and for the third point, we're identified with souls. That's all I need, I think, here. In the symposium, we learned that souls are kind of in flux as well as the body. So we have that part, and I'm just running with that. I agree that there is an ascetic-sounding tone to a lot of the conversation here, but that's, I think that gets into lots of figures here.
I'd like to ask a question on another point from the point you mentioned in your talk. You compare the beauty as an ultimate cause of fitting arrangement in the symposium with the beauty appearing in Daedalus Blues in the Phaedo. But I think the more proper correspondence takes place between the beauty of the symposium and the good of the Phaedo as the ultimate cause of generation and destruction and all things being. How about that?
The audio here is kind of messy. So you were saying that, I'm focusing on beauty as a cause of fitting arrangement in
the symposium.
Yeah.
And the better correspondent in the Phaedo is not the beauty, but the good of the theological ultimate cause.
So the good would be more fitting to be a cause of fitting arrangement.
Yes.
Yeah, well, I think the focus on generation in the Phaedo is interesting. And so, at least to me, generation then recalls reproduction.
Yeah, but it's not only generation, but good generation, harmonious generation in the Phaedo. And so it's only a suggestion, not a question.
Yeah. Well, I think this also gets to this question that I'm not sure that I have a line on. I work mostly on Aristotle, so I dip my toes into these waters selectively. But Brett, what is the relation between the good and the beautiful?
Thank you. I think it's, even if it is willfully perverse, perhaps, we should have a little perversity. One brief textual comment and then a question. In your parallels between the Symposium and the Phaedo, you say that both are re-narrated years later. But I think the opening lines of the Phaedo suggest it's really perhaps within a year or two and no more that Phaedo is listening to this. That's a minor point. My question is, if we go with you and suggest that the Phaedo is really suggesting a qualified immortality based only on Socrates' intellectual reproduction, what do we make of the famous passage in Theaetetus where Socrates says that he is barren and does not reproduce anything? He simply midwives the reproduction of other things. In that case, would Socrates really just be completely mortal and so dead?
Yeah, he would be. But but what about the other pet? Right. I mean, that point is well taken about the Theaetetus and his own presentation there. I guess we would have to balance that with the remark that those assembled at his death feel like their children losing a father. Right, it's a nice complication that I have to deal with if I'm going to wish this line. I don't have anything especially healthy here.
Thank you. We have time for one more short question.
You provide a lot of interesting things to think about, but I'm worried about a bunch of other passages, including the whole story about recollection that presupposes rebirth in the Phaedo itself, plus the myth of her in the Republic, the myth in the Phaedrus of the winged soul, the chariot, and all that sort of thing. The Timaeus, where the souls go into their stars and so forth. This isn't just a quirk in the Phaedo, and we may not like the way he does things, but it does seem to be a pattern of explanation coming back again and again, even in places where we don't expect it and don't like it. And it seems there's a lot of evidence on the other side.
Yeah, so maybe there are two kinds of questions there. One would have to do with how we assess the argument from recollection and what seems to be, there it seems to be committed to the soul's pre-existence before embodiment. And then secondly, there's a question about a cluster of myths that we find in Plato that seem to be committed to a kind of unqualified immortality. I guess one issue with the recollection argument would be that at most it would show that the soul exists before embodiment, but it wouldn't show that it exists after death, which I take it as a constraint on that argument to establish unqualified immortality. There might be things you can do with that. I think we need to look carefully at Socrates' exchange with his interlocutors and see the extent to which his interlocutors are grabbing on eagerly to certain kinds of views that perhaps Socrates is proposing, but not necessarily committing himself to. As for the myths, again, we need to look at those as myths. Perhaps, right, I've looked at the final myth in the Phaedo as suggesting some kind of something like a metaphorical portrayal of qualified immortality. Perhaps there are ways of reading the myth of error in that way. The myth in the Phaedrus, that's a tough one for my account, but I would then I find the Phaedrus a very difficult dialogue, and I'm not sure what Plato's view is about myth in that dialogue, given the second half and the turn toward much non-mythical motive discourse, and for the Timaeus, it's a little bit related. But thanks. Yeah.
So I thank you all for the session. I have a message for you before closing. It says, there are members of the IPS, if you would like to make a small contribution to give a little present to the organizers for their efforts, please contact either Lydia Palumbo or Beatrice Bossi before 1 p.m. We would suggest 20 reals. Thank you for your kind attention. And that's it. Thank you very much.